What is going on, everybody? James Hancock here. I'm back to offer a very enthusiastic review for episode 6 of season 3 of The Orville New Horizons, an episode called Twice in a Lifetime, written by Seth MacFarlane. And this episode worked really well for a variety of reasons. A, it was just an incredible story. It was a mix of heartfelt emotion as well as extraordinary comedy. But I loved how it tied back to one of the best episodes of season 2, which was season 2, episode 11. I just call it the smoking episode. It was the episode where Bordas got horribly addicted to cigarettes, but it was also the episode where Malloy fell in love with somebody who had been dead for centuries. Laura, who had placed her her iPhone in a time capsule, which allowed him to discover her. And I thought that episode, like this episode, once again, it's the perfect blend of heart and humor, which is kind of the essence of what the Orville is all about when it's really firing on all cylinders. But I guess there's always that third leg of the stool where the Orville secretly is a brilliant sci-fi show, which no one really gives it credit for. But if you're interested in stories about temporal paradoxes and time travel, this is yet another example of this show's incredible science fiction credentials. But one of the main reasons that this episode, as well as season 2, episode 11, were so emotionally impactful to me, it's because of that song, That's All I've Got to Say, which was originally written by Jimmy Webb and performed by the band America for the movie The Last Unicorn. And I saw The Last Unicorn in the theater with my grandmother as a little kid. I've always thought it was just an absolutely magical animated movie that gets kind of casually dismissed as a kid's movie. But it's a really cool, dark, eerie fantasy movie in a lot of ways with brilliant voice work by people like Jeff Bridges, who sings this song, That's All I've Got to Say, alongside Mia Farrow. But you've also got Christopher Lee in there. And anyway, if you've only ever thought of The Last Unicorn as a movie for like toddlers, go back and watch it again, and you will just be absolutely knocked flat. And you'll also be wondering to yourself, how come kids' animated movies today are so innocent and so risk-averse and so boring by comparison? And yeah, Band America plays a huge role in the power of that movie. And obviously Seth MacFarlane is a music freak and loves bringing those ingredients into the show. And so at the beginning of this latest episode, we see Malloy playing once again, That's All I've Got to Say, on the acoustic guitar. And he can just sing his ass off. Very powerful scene. It seems like almost this whole show is an excuse for Seth MacFarlane to hang out with really cool actors and performers so they can just get shit-faced and play music, which, you know, more power to you. It's a really good gig. This episode begins and ends with people just getting ripped. And those scenes always feel very personal to me. That's kind of like what Seth MacFarlane's probably like behind the scenes. At any rate, let's dig into this episode. The catalyst for this whole story is the fact that they've now found a way to extend the power of the Aeronov device to the point where it could impact an entire ship like the size of the Orville. And Ted Danson makes one of his great cameos and warns them that the weaponization of time travel could be, A, just horribly disruptive to anybody who's experimenting with it, but also be a weapon that the Kalons would basically do everything in their power to try and get a hold of. Something tells me we're going to see that egg salad sandwich that got transported 3 months into the future. How it'll have an impact later in the season, who can say? But they share the warning that one of the big risks with temporal paradoxes is if you say you're going to send an egg salad sandwich back in time in a few minutes and then fail to do so, you can create split timelines. And I thought that's where this episode was going to go, because in this battle with the Kalon, when they're trying to steal this device, when Malloy gets sent back in time, we see him kind of exploding into a bunch of different people. I was like, oh shit, are we going to see like different Malloys popping up in all these timeline variants? But no, he's just sent back in time to 2015 because that's the period he's thinking of because of the cell phone from Laura from way back in the day. But before we get into the story between him and Laura, I just want to, I guess, sing this show's praises for giving us another kick-ass epic space battle. Everybody thinks this show is just some comedy that's kind of loosely, that feels like kind of sort of like Star Trek. But you watch a battle like that and you're like, God damn, like, why can't most big budget science fiction movies be as dramatically satisfying as that? The chasing was incredible. You really get a sense of just how dangerous the Kalons are with that entire space station that's just been torn to smithereens. all these ships are getting their asses kicked, and they decide to flee away. The Orville gets stuck in a tractor beam, which is why they have to... Basically, this is the episode where we really get to see Lamar showing off what a badass scientist and engineer he is, because he cooks up, along with Isaac, a way to get free, which overloads the little Aronov device at any rate. Malloy gets sent back. He finds a way to send a signal hundreds of years into the future, you know, long after he has lived his entire life back there and died, and the Orville decides that they're going to try and go back in time and save him. Also, quick side note, people always compare this show to Star Trek, but it feels like the Star Wars references are always flowing in pretty much every single episode, where even when they're going to that space station to deliver the device into safekeeping, we see Kelly saying, "I have a bad feeling about this," which obviously is one of those kind of catchphrases from the original Star Wars trilogy that you hear over and over and over again. In any event, the Orville goes back in time, but they kind of miss the mark. They arrive in 2025, and that's where things get interesting, because as we come to learn, Malloy was very conscious of the fact that while back in time, he could accidentally disrupt the timeline. So he lived in seclusion for a long time, using his handheld device to kill and eat animals, which is very frowned upon in the far distant future. But at a certain point, he decided just to live his life, and he went and looked up Lara, and they fell in love, and they had a kid, and they've got another one on the way. He is happy. He's a pilot. He loves 21st century culture in terms of, I guess for me, it'd be like getting to go back to like the 1970s and work in like the Hollywood of that time, which is a period I really like, or the Hollywood of the 1920s. Everybody's got certain periods that they're nostalgic about, even if they didn't experience them firsthand. And the main emotional thrust of this episode is the fact that Malloy does not want to go back to the future, but Ed and Kelly are basically saying, look, we're going to take you back by force, whether you like it or not. This is a bigger issue than just your own personal happiness. But the episode would have gotten pretty heavy if not for the fact that we have this parallel adventure where Ensign Burke and Isaac have to go on a mission to get, I can't remember the name of the ore, but they got to get this rare ore to basically get the time travel device up and running again. And as I predicted back at the beginning of the season, I knew that the tension between Burke and Isaac would lead to them being forced to go on a mission together, because while Burke will probably never completely forgive Isaac for playing a role in the death of the woman that she loved and never really got a chance to express her true feelings to, they do have to set aside their differences for a common cause. And there were some moments in this episode that just had me screaming with laughter. They show up at this biker bar, and my one knock against this episode is that they're playing the Rolling Stones tune, "Can't You Hear Me Knocking?" In my opinion, anytime a filmmaker has used a song really well or in an iconic fashion, you kind of have to leave it alone for the rest of the time. And "Can't You Hear Me Knocking?" is used in the film Casino by Scorsese, and it's probably the most powerful sequence of that entire movie. So it'd be like taking Staying Alive from like Saturday Night Fever and putting in your movie. Just feel like certain songs, just leave them alone. There are a lot of songs out there. Go look for them. In any event, they go into this biker bar, and they decide they're going to gamble with arm wrestling in order to get some motorbikes. And we see Isaac trying to pretend as if he's not incredibly strong. And he's like, "Oh no, I am losing." Or, "It would appear that this is not one of your hobbies." He just, in the most deadpan fashion possible, he delivers just incredible comedy. Or later on, when they're visiting the house that's for sale that happens to be located above the ore that they're looking for, he has these lines like, "Our pairing has flourished for some time," or, "Negative, insemination has yet to occur." I love Isaac. Isaac might be my not-so-secret favorite character on the show at this point. At any rate, Isaac and Burke, they make a great team, and it'll be interesting to see where they stand with each other by the end of the season. But that's not the only bit of comedy in the episode. Maybe the best laugh all episode is we see back on the ship that Lamar's been dealing with some aches and pains, but he's been working really hard. He hasn't had a chance to really look into it. And we see how Tala steps in and offers to help assist. And, you know, she's incredibly strong. She starts massaging certain parts on his back, and he's like, "You gotta be kidding me with this shit." Anyway, I was already cracking up. You know, the crew is all looking up like wondering what's going on. But then when the massage ends, they just look at each other and they just pounce and get it on. It was super hot. This show isn't often like hot and sexy, but that was one moment where I was like, all right, yeah, that's gonna get everybody's juices flowing. But getting back to the real meat of this episode, or the real moral and ethical dilemma, is what to do about Malloy and his family, because Ed and Kelly are in a position where their sense of duty is going to, I guess, prevail over their notions of friendship, because one family's happiness is pretty insignificant in comparison to the timeline. Like the old line in Casablanca when Bogey says, the problems of three little people don't amount to a hill of beans in this crazy world. Or as they say in Naked Gun, but this is our hill and these are our beans. Anyway, I digress. But we see how Malloy is basically holding him off at gunpoint to stay with his family. And then Ed just says, look, I'm going to go back 10 more years and grab you before you fell in love and essentially erase this kid from existence. These are incredibly complex ethical questions, and I thought the show really handled them as well as you could possibly imagine. I guess if you want to be an idealist, you could say, well, when they go back in time and find Malloy like a couple months after he first was thrown back in time, maybe there's a divergent alternate timeline where Malloy gets to remain with his family, or maybe that got completely erased. It all depends upon how you interpret time travel. Everything I know about time travel, I basically have learned from like movies like Back to the Future or Avengers Endgame. So let's just say my knowledge of time travel is superficial and paper thin. And then we get one of the best kind of sci-fi moments out of all three seasons of the show, where the Aronov device is totally fried, which in a way is kind of a good thing because that weapon won't fall into the wrong hands. But Malloy goes full mad scientist mode and cooks up an idea where they can get back to the future. But his idea is this. And once again, I have not studied the theory of relativity since 1995, the last time I took a physics class. But when they travel at warp speed in the context of this fictional setting, they essentially have a protective bubble that protects them from the passage of time, because the faster you approach the speed of light, the faster basically the time-space continuum passes around you. Or anyway, they said it better in the show. That's their show, not mine. But he comes up with this idea of removing that protective bubble, and they're basically just going to blast out one direction, come about, blast back, and 400 years will have gone by. And it just looked so goddamn cool watching them do this. I just feel like this is what Star Trek used to do so well. This episode, I guess there's a lot of common ground between this episode and classic episodes of Star Trek, like in the original series when they would have to dress in civilian clothes and for like, you know, hanging out with like gangsters, whatever the case might be. Seeing the crew of the Orville in 21st century attire was really cool. But also, I guess the episode reminded me quite a bit of the Star Trek movie, The Voyage Home, as well. Or at least had some similar DNA, but mission accomplished. They go back to 2415 or thereabouts. And then Ed and Kelly and Malloy sit down. And Malloy is on their side about the horrible ethical decision they had to make on his behalf. And they decide that they're going to kick back and get completely ripped like they used to back when they were young. The three of them are very old friends, and there's a lot of history there. And then perfectly on cue, the music from The Last Unicorn kicks in. And once again, I'm almost about to like get misty-eyed describing it right now, but I would love to hear from people who are much younger than I am how they respond to that song. Because obviously, if you didn't see Last Unicorn as a little kid, like with your grandmother, like I did, does that song have the same emotional resonance? Who knows? I mean, music's so subjective and affects everybody differently. But I don't know why that song gets to me the way it does. It could just be nostalgia. It could be me being sentimental. Who knows? But long story short, home run episode, maybe the best episode of the season so far. And we still got many episodes to go. So I continue to love and adore everything about this show. And I hope everyone out there is enjoying the show as much as I am. But before I go, I got to give a quick shout out to my sponsor, Manscaped, the world's foremost experts in men's below-the-waist grooming. We might need to get the Orville to do an episode about just that age-old question about to shave or not to shave. But their products are precision engineered to look after all your bits and pieces in your John Thomas. And it's summer, beach season. If you want to look good, if like a skinny dipping party suddenly erupts and whatever party you might be attending, well, you want to make sure that you're ready to rise, and pun very much intended, to the occasion. So Go to manscaped.com, use the discount code WRONGREAL in all caps, and it'll get you 20% off any purchase, and I highly recommend the Performance Package 4.0. But I hope you enjoyed this review. If so, remember to like the video, subscribe to the channel, hit that notification bell. Hope everyone has an amazing weekend, but more importantly, as always, onwards and upwards.